everybody. And I must say, welcome winter with this weather we're having. As you can see, there's a few people that decided to rather stay at home, and I don't blame them. So a big thank you for all of you who braved this weather conditions to get down to some sharky business tonight with us. So my name is Kari. I do marketing for Marine Dynamics and the Dyer Island Conservation Trust. Thank you so much for your support. Every cent counts. So with your support tonight, there's a few penguins that's getting fed this week. Thank you so much. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce you to our marine biologist all the way from Italy, Elena Milanese.
Milanese.
Okay, that's what she's going to tell us a little bit more about herself anyway. So thank you so much, and we're looking forward to hearing from you.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. Hello. Okay, good evening to everyone. So first of all, thank you very much everyone for coming here to listen to me, besides the weather. So again, my name is Elena Milanese. I'm from Italy, and the purpose of this talk is to introduce a little bit myself, my background, and in particular the thesis project that I did in French Polynesia. So again, I don't want to be too much egocentric, I'm so sorry, just to give you a brief overview. So again, I'm from Italy, as you hear by my strong accent, I'm so sorry, I'm trying to smooth it a little bit, but it's not working. So I am a marine biologist, so I hold a bachelor degree in environmental sciences, and then I decided to specialize in marine sciences for my master, and I did that in Milan. I did an international degree in marine sciences. So why I did that in Milan? Because it's landlocked, because that is a good question. So actually, we got a master degree in English. So we had a lot of opportunity to do experiences abroad with scholarships. So I did a lot of experiences abroad. So this is why then I chose to study there. What I'm doing now, I'm here in South Africa with Marine Dynamics. I'm a guide, mainly on the shark cage diving trips. So just to give you a brief background about myself, so how everything started. So basically, I think my passion for the ocean, for marine conservation, grew up through the years. So since I was a child, I always got fascinated about the ocean, probably because it was something too far from me. I always live in a landlocked place. So for me, going to the sea with my parents during holiday was something that I was waiting all year, and it was something super that was super fascinating me. So then when I graduated in high school, I wasn't sure what to do about my future. So then I decided to volunteer in a sea turtle rescue center in the south of Italy, in Lampedusa, and because it was in one of the best islands in Italy, I decided to go there for 2 weeks. So I volunteered there. I was basically taking care of the sea turtle. This is the Lampedusa, and in the south of Italy, in Sicily. I was taking care of sea turtle injuries. I was cleaning the tanks, feeding the sea turtles, making guides with tourists about the reason why sea turtles were there, making some educational with tourists. And basically, I got passionate about marine conservation. So thanks to this experience made me realize that I wanted to pursue this career, so contribute to the preservation of vulnerable species like sea turtles. So then I decided to enroll in university. Of course, I couldn't enroll in a marine biology degree because I was in Milan, so I enrolled first in environmental sciences and then on marine sciences for the master degree. Then during my academic career, I always try to do as many experiences as possible just to understand more about what I wanted specifically to do with marine conservation. So I did my internship of the bachelor in the Maldives, because in the Maldives there was an hotspot of my university. So there is a research station there where they're doing mainly coral restoration. So I did my internship there for 10 days. So I was studying the tropical ecology of the Maldives. Then I went in Montenegro, where I studied marine mammals for the first time. So I was part of the Montenegro Dolphin Project. So we were studying the dolphins of the Bay of Montenegro. So we were doing a lot of land surveys, but also surveys on the boat, doing some photo ID technique with dolphins. Then I had two of the most significant experience for me, the most formative ones. So for my master's degree, I went in Mexico. Was my first approach with shark research. And then finally, I got in French Polynesia. I got the opportunity to go there for 6 months where I did my master thesis project. So tonight in particular, I want to talk more specifically about the thesis project that I did in French Polynesia because it was the most significant experience for me so far before coming here. So my master thesis project basically is about the effect of the climate change on sharks. So why I decided to study in particular this topic, basically because I got passionate about climate change thanks to the thesis that I did for my bachelor degree. So as I said before, I did my bachelor in environmental sciences, but then I got the opportunity to do a thesis with a marine topic. So we studied the effect of the climate change on the physiology of the jellyfish because climate change is threatening many marine animals, but is also causing proliferation of jellyfish. So these are called the jellyfish bloom. So we wanted to understand how the jellyfish are reacting to the increasing of the temperature of the water in the ocean. So I studied two different species of jellyfish, so Aurelia, this one with the Mediterranean distribution, and then Filoriza punctata with the more tropical distribution, and I did the experiment at the Aquarium of Genova in Italy, in the center part of Italy. So then for my master, for the curricular internship of my master, I went in Mexico, as I said. So this was my real first approach with shark research area. So I worked with a non-profit organization that is called Pelagios Cajunja. Was in Baja California Sur, just below California. And here I studied different species of sharks. So whale sharks, silky sharks, bull sharks. So we did a lot of activity. We deploy underwater camera, BRAFs. We did some photo ID technique. I did several expeditions by boat to tag some sharks, to measure some sharks. So thanks to this experience, then I really got passionate about sharks. So it's where I understood that this was one of my main things, the things that I wanted to pursue with my career as a marine biologist. So then, because of these two things, so climate change and sharks, I wanted to study more specifically sharks, so from a physiological point of view, in particular understand which is the impact of the climate change that is one of the major concerns for the marine biodiversity, specifically on sharks. So then I found out about this project that is called the PhysioShark Project. So it's a project that is an annual monitoring program that is has a base in French Polynesia. So from October to January, they are always having this monitoring program. In particular, they're studying juvenile sharks and the effect of the temperature variability on neonat sharks, black tip reef sharks in particular. So I stayed in this research station that is called the CRIOB, where I did my study and where also was my home for 6 months. So the thesis project, as I said, I did that in French Polynesia. Where is French Polynesia? Is in the middle of nowhere in the Pacific Ocean. As a vast, large surface area, actually, is bigger than the one of Europe. It's composed by many islands, so more than 100 islands that are divided in several archipelagos. So the archipelago on which I was the archipelago of the Society Island, and in particular the island was Morea, this one, that is characterized by two distinctive bays, and the research station where I was in at the end of one of the two bays, so in Oponohu Bay. So which is the meaning of Morea? Just a curiosity, this means yellow lizard in Tahitian language, not because there are a lot of yellow lizards actually on the island, there are no lizards. So the name, it's because of a legend. So basically, back in the times, this is a legend, of course. So they found out a huge yellow lizard washed up on one of the beaches of Morea. And this giant yellow lizard was abandoned by the parents because it was growing too much. So these parents were too worried that this lizard at a certain point was trying to kill them. So they decided to abandon this lizard in the ocean. The lizard was hit by strong currents and then was washed on one of the beaches of Morea. So when the fishermen found out this huge lizard, they started to shout, this is a yellow lizard, Morea, Morea. That Morea means in that language, yellow lizard, so this is why. So these are just a few pictures that I took once I stayed there. So as you see, it's literally a paradise. It's one of the most touristic destinations in French Polynesia. It's an honeymoon destination, not in my case, of course. And so it's a paradise for biodiversity. It has an incredible biodiversity, both on land, because it's a volcanic island, and both underwater for the coral reef ecosystem. So, as I said, it's a volcanic island and is surrounded by a shallow lagoon that is connected by the ocean by 12 passes. Passes is just a transition, a connection between shallow water and the ocean, the ones that I highlighted there. And this is one of the bay that I said before. This is the Oponohu Bay. At the end of this bay, there was the research station. Basically, Morea has an oceanic climate, so we have a transition between the wet season and the dry season. So I was there during the wet season because actually the wet season coincides with the parturition season of the black-tip reef sharks. So it's a warm and humid season. And this lagoon, this shallow lagoon, is divided in different units. So we have the fringing reef, that is the first part adjacent to the land. Then we have a deep channel, and then we have the back reef. So basically, I was fishing black-tip reef sharks in the fringing reef, so in the most shallow part, that is characterized by sandy patches and coral aggregation. Then, so as I said, there is an incredible biodiversity of animals, in particular of marine animals in French Polynesia, but in particular of sharks. Why? Because French Polynesia is one of the biggest shark sanctuary in the world. So shark sanctuary is actually one of the most efficient management action for the protection of the sharks, where sharks in a particular area, they are protected from human activities that they are controlled partially or fully controlled. So human activities like fishing, boat traffic, and so on. So most of the shark sanctuary, they are located in the Pacific Ocean, as you see, and the one of French Polynesia is one of the biggest ones. So there is an incredible biodiversity of sharks. There are many species of sharks. And in particular, all the sharks here, they're associated with the coral reef ecosystem, like in all the tropical places. Why this? Because the coral reef ecosystem provides a lot of benefit for the sharks. So first of all, provide a lot of refuge from predators where they can hide, like juvenile sharks. Also provide a lot of prey, availability of prey, so a lot of food. But conversely, also sharks are really important to keep the balance of the ecosystem. So for instance, they control the population of invasive species, a species that they are not supposed to be there. And so by feeding on these species, they keep the control of the ecosystem. They keep the ecosystem in an health status. And also they contribute, for instance, also to the cycling of the nutrients. So in both cases, sharks are fundamental for the reef ecosystem. And speaking about the sharks that usually stay in the associated to the reef, we can divide sharks mainly into groups. So reef-associated mesopredator, that they are basically small shark species, that they are mostly associated with the reef, so they are not migratory species, they're mostly staying there. And then we have transient apex predator. They're still sharks associated with the reef, but they're migratory species, they're large body species, and they migrate between different kinds of ecosystem. So in Morea in particular, regarding reef-associated mesopredator, we have like nurse sharks, white-tip reef sharks, grey reef sharks, black-tip reef sharks, of course, and then transient apex predator. The most common one are tiger sharks, great emerald sharks, oceanic white-tip reef sharks. So the species that I studied, the protagonist of this talk, is the black-tip reef sharks. So regarding briefly, black-tip reef sharks belong to one of the most common family of sharks, one of the biggest, the family Carcharinidae. It's a reef mesopredatory reef-associated sharks, so it's a small shark species, so maximum length 1.5 meters, and is one of the most common species of sharks found in the Indo-Pacific coral reef, but in particular in French Polynesia. The conservation status actually is vulnerable, and this is because of their distribution, because they are mostly found in shallow water, so quite close to the coast, and so subjected to many human activities, so mainly fishing, accidental fishing or targeting fishing. because it's a mesopredatory reef-associated sharks, as I said before, they have a quite limited habitat range, so they mostly stay associated to the reef in shallow water, and they are viviparous species. What does it mean, viviparous species? Basically, females give birth to live youngs, as you see in this picture. So after a long gestation period inside the placenta, the females, they approach the coast in order to give birth to these miniature-like sharks. So they look like the adults, but they're just smaller, so 60 centimeters in length for the black-tip reef sharks, and they do that close to the shore. So basically, close to the shore, we have the nursery area of sharks, of black-tip reef sharks in this case, and they are essential habitat, crucial habitat for the sharks, for different life stages actually, so both for adults, for the females, because the females, they exploit these habitats for the gestation period because they are warmer water, so these enhance the gestation of the females, and then also for the breeding actually of the sharks, but then they are particularly important for the juveniles, because the juveniles, it's one of the most vulnerable life stages of the sharks, because they are quite small, as you see from the picture, so they are heavily affected by the predatory activity of adults, even of the same species. So juveniles, they need to stay in shallow water for the first year of life because there is shallow water, so the predator, they cannot enter to predate on them because it's too shallow, and also because mainly there is a lot of food available. So they can feed, they can grow faster, and the goal is actually to reach the sexual maturity as fast as possible to be grown enough and so to don't be predated by other adult sharks. So this nursery area in particular around Morea, so turning back to our study area, is along the Fringing Reef, we found many types of nursery area for sharks. So we have, they are all protected areas, so protected bays, mangroves, and reef ecosystem. So all shallow water that are quite productive with abundance of food where the newborn sharks exploit this area, in particular during the season when they born, so during the wet season. So there are a lot of advantages in staying in this shallow water. So as I said, there are a lot of prey available, so they can grow faster, but in particular, they can hide from the predator. So these are the main benefits for the juvenile sharks in exploiting these areas. Why? There are some disadvantages. Of course, there are disadvantages. So the main threat, they actually can be divided in natural threat and anthropogenic threat, okay? So threats that they are caused by the human activity. So regarding the natural threat in this shallow water, because they're quite shallow, we have a huge fluctuation of environmental parameters, okay? So mostly temperature, salinity, pH, and oxygen. In particular, I want to focus on the temperature because it's the aim of my study. So basically, in the light of the climate change, two major things are threatening the survival of sharks that are the long-term effect of the ocean warming, so due to the emission of the greenhouse gases in the atmosphere of carbon dioxide, these are absorbed by the ocean, that is also called actually a carbon sink, and this is, in the long term, is causing the long and gradual and unchanged increase of the temperature of the water. So it's expected with the future projection that the temperature of the water will increase of about 4 degrees Celsius in the over 70 years. And then this is coupling with the fact that also this shallow water are experiencing nowadays a lot of extreme events. So extreme events, actually, they are short term events of drastic increase or drastic decrease of water. So marine heat waves in the case we have the increasing of the water, or cold snaps in the case we have a drastic decrease of the water during the day. So these two, they are affecting the marine biodiversity, especially in these shallow waters. So this is graph, it's quite explicative of this fact. So we have the extreme event and then the long-term effect of the ocean warming due to the climate change. So the disadvantages of the sharks, they are basically natural stressors, so as I said, high environmental variability, but also due to the fact that these sharks, they are quite close to the coast. So what does it mean, close to human activities? So the main threat, they are actually habitat degradation, so basically modification of the coastline for construction, for instance, of luxury resort, or so this, because it's close to the coast, is removing habitats that then can be exploited by the juvenile sharks. So these again are some of the stressors that the neonatal sharks are facing in shallow water. So for instance, terrestrial runoff, so when we have basically the release of wastes, materials, of pollutants in the water, these reduce the quality of the water. Then we have the, as I said before, habitat degradation. So for instance, around Morea, the construction of luxury resort, this is actually coinciding with the habitat that they are exploited by the neonatal sharks, so then they don't have any more a place where they can stay. Then we have, of course, the problem of the fishing. And then also, unluckily, around Marea, there are some shark feeding points. So these, again, create some more stressful condition for the sharks. So coupling these two things, actually two are the solution for the sharks. In stressful condition, they can actually change the habitat range, so move toward other areas where they are more safe, where there are not so many stressors, or physiologically adapt. So the things is that adult sharks, they can exploit a higher habitat range, so they can move in many habitats. Neonatal sharks, as I said before, they are constrained to shallow water because they need to grow faster, because they cannot stay in the open ocean, otherwise they will be predated. So they need to stay in shallow water. So basically what I say is that this shallow water, they're kind of becoming an ecological trap for neonatal sharks, because they cannot move, they need to stay there, and the conditions are threatening their survival. So in order to survive, they need to physiologically adapt. So the physiological adaptation is the only way of the neonatal sharks to stay there and to cope with these new changing conditions. So this is why I did my study. So the aim of my study is actually understanding how these neonatal sharks are physiologically adapt to the variability of the temperature of the water in the light of the climate change. So how the extreme event, for instance, the shark temperature changes, but also the effect of the ocean warming are threatening the survival of neonatal sharks from a physiological point of view. Because as I say, the physiological adaptation is the only way of neonatal sharks that have to adapt to the new condition. So what I did, basically, my whole study can be divided in three main parts. So I will explain each part to just let you understand more about my study. So there was a fieldwork part in which I fished these neonatal sharks around Morea. Then we collect these sharks and we did some experiment in captivity conditions, so in control experimental condition, in the laboratory of the research station. And then I analyzed basically the blood of these sharks and I made some laboratory analysis. So first I will speak about the fieldwork. So I collect the newborn sharks around the island of Morea in five specific sites. So newborn sharks we consider newborn sharks all the sharks less than 70 centimeters of length. So in order to do that, just a brief overview about the five sites that I choose. Why we choose this site? Mainly because of the distance from the research station, because we need to collect these sharks and bring them at the research station. So we wanted to minimize as much as possible the stress to the shark. So these places, there were less than 30 minutes of distance by car, by vehicle to the research station. So these are all the pictures of the fishing sites that we visited. So as you see, they are all corresponding to the nursery area that the sharks usually exploit during the wet season when they born. So we have a reef ecosystem, we have mangrove, we have protected bays. So what I used to fish these sharks, we used monofilament gill nets. that is this net with a mesh size of 5 centimeters. Why we use specifically this one? Because we understood that was the best way, the most efficient way to fish these newborn sharks, to don't threat their body. And also the size of the mesh of the lines was too small also to get entangled some adults. So we didn't want that, because otherwise the adults would scare the neonates, and so was not efficient anymore our fishing. So basically these fishing gears was long 50 meters. So explaining briefly about the procedure of the fishing. So we prepare all the material on the beach. Then we set up the fishing line perpendicular to the shore, just walking in the shallow water. And then we check the net in all the length. So we make the fishing at dusk time, so between 5 and 8 p.m. every night. So a total fishing effort of 3 hours. So this was coinciding so with the sunset, so most of the time was dark. So we had to check all the net every 30 minutes, because we didn't want to cause any further stress to the sharks, because sometimes it was possible to see the shark when the sharks eat the net for the splash on the water, basically. But then when it was darker, sometimes it was not really possible to understand if the shark was really in the net or not. So we didn't want to let the sharks too much struggle in the net, so we had to check the net every 30 minutes just to be sure that there was nothing entangled. Then once the sharks eat the net, quickly we went to the net to disentangle the sharks, of course, in the lowest time as possible, carefully making sure that we didn't damage any part of the body of the sharks. So taking off the nylon thread, and then once release the sharks, we basically, like before, we walk back to the beach with the sharks underwater, because again, we wanted to let the sharks breathe, of course, we didn't want to stress so much the sharks. And once on the beach, then the sharks was transferred in insulated cooler, previously prepared on the back of the vehicle. And in this cooler, there was aerated seawater. So aerated because we connected diving tanks to the cooler. So in this way, the shark were still able to breathe inside the cooler. So now we'll show you a video about the fishing procedure, some clips that we got during the field work. You will see the sampling in the field. I did the sampling for my project in the tanks, but I just wanted to show you quickly how I sampled the blood, and then later I will explain you better all the blood sampling procedure. So basically, so this is one of the nursery sites that we visited. So as I said before, we set up the net by walking. Then you see now the baby sharks that hit the net. So as soon as the sharks hit the net, in this case was clearly visible by the splash, so I went there to get the shark. The shark, of course, was released in the lowest time as possible. Once released the sharks, we walked back to the shore, keeping the sharks underwater and holding the sharks in 2 points, so at the 8 of the gills and of the caudal tail. The sharks then we put in the insulated cooler, and then now you see me sampling the blood, putting the sharks in tonic immobility, and then taking up the blood. So you see now with the syringe that I took the blood from the sharks, and then the sharks after that was released in the shortest time as possible, always to minimize the stress, far from the net, because sometimes the sharks hit the net again, so far from the net, and then now you see the shark just swimming away. He's a really cute shark. Back to the wild. So this is basically how we collect the sharks. So then after collecting the sharks, we transport them back to the research station. So now I will talk about the experiment that we did in captivity at the research station. So basically we put the sharks in the holding tanks. So we prepared previously 4 holding tanks. And these tanks were connected to a circular flow through system. This one that I highlighted in the circle. So this system was ensuring always the a constant supply of aerated and filtered seawater. This thanks to the fact that these tanks, the research station in general, was connected to offshore pumps that were constantly taking seawater from the lagoon. Okay, so constantly filtered seawater was ensured to the tanks, and these tanks, of course, they were aerated again with oxygen inside. And also in these tanks, all these tanks were always covered by plastic shade net, as you see here, the green ones, and this again to minimize the stress of the sharks, so any external disturbances, so visual and acoustic disturbance. So we put the sharks inside the tanks, so maximum 4 sharks per tank, again to let the sharks have enough space to be comfortable in the sharks, again to minimize the stress of the sharks as possible. I want to point out this because we didn't harm any sharks, so we wanted to keep the shark in the most comfortable state as possible. Then we analyzed, these are the sharks in the tanks, so totally fine as you see. So I analyzed in total 20 newborn sharks. So basically I did 6 rounds of collection. So once the experiment with groups of sharks was finished, we released back the sharks in the wild, and then we collect other sharks again until the number was reached. So in order to ensure the right health and behavior, and the health status and the behavior of the sharks in the tanks, we constantly check the water quality parameter inside the tanks, so temperature, pH, oxygen. I was feeding the sharks every 2 days with tuna, corresponding to 5% of their body weight. And then we manipulated basically the temperature of the water to simulate what is happening in the lagoon with the chillers and heaters. Now I will explain a little bit this. So this is basically the experimental design. So without worrying too much, so basically after a first acclimatation period, acclimatation means that we wanted the sharks to return back to their physiological status in the tanks, the ones that they are used to have in their natural condition. So before starting the experiment, we let the sharks stay in the tanks 1 week, just feeding them without stressing with temperature. Then after this acclimatation period, I started to change the temperature of the tanks, because what we wanted to do was to replicate a short-term temperature changes, that is the one that is supposed to happen in the lagoon, so to understand what is happening from a physiological point of view on the shark. So we put a warm stress and a cold stress. So I raised the temperature and I lowered the temperature from the natural natural condition of 27 degrees, so we changed it of 2 degrees Celsius, okay? So that is what's supposed to happen nowadays in the lagoon of Morea. So we keep the temperature stress warm and cold for 48 hours, and then after the temperature stress, I lower down the temperature, I raise back down the temperature to the normal condition. Then after the temperature stress, we let the sharks again be in the tanks for a recovery period, and after the recovery period, we release them sharks in the same nursery site where they were collected. So sharks were collected in different nursery sites, and each shark was released in its own nursery area, because as I said, newborn sharks, they had really high site fidelity, so we kind of have really resident newborn sharks in each nursery area, so we didn't want to mix the population. So basically how I understood the stress status, the physiological status of the sharks doing blood analysis. So as we basically do with ourselves, so to check our health status, our health condition, we go monthly, I don't know, annually to do blood analysis. So I did the same with sharks. Blood is fundamental, is a fundamental fluid in animals, in organisms, including sharks. It's fundamental for transport oxygen, nutrients, and so basically how, when I analyzed, I sampled this blood, I sampled 4 times per sharks. So at the beginning, so during the acclimatation, when the shark was not stressed for the temperature, then I sampled the sharks 2 times during the temperature stress, so at the beginning of the temperature stress and after 24 hours, and then I sampled the blood at the end during the recovery period. So to show you more about the sampling of the blood, so just to be to clarify this, I didn't kill the sharks, so the shark was already in the research center because they had previously a shark for dissection purpose, for research purpose. So we just wanted to understand more with these sharks about the point of the blood sampling. So basically, the procedure of sampling blood, as you see previously in the video, I put the shark in tonic immobility, so with the ventral part putting the shark upside down. Then I used a syringe flushed before with heparin. Heparin is actually a substance that is avoiding the coagulation of the blood because I didn't want the blood to coagulate, otherwise I couldn't do the analysis of the blood. So then I put the syringe in the midline of the caudal peduncle. The caudal peduncle, so is the part between the anal fin and the caudal fin. Then I pierced the caudal musculature, I touched the vertebral column. Once I touched the vertebral column, I knew that I was in the caudal vasculature, so arteries and veins, and then I drawn 2 milliliters of blood, more or less, per sharks, and everything was done in less than 2 minutes. Okay? Then, so these are pictures regarding the sampling of the blood of the sharks in the tanks. So once I sample the blood, then I put the blood in insulated cooler with ice packs, so to keep the blood, the biological sample, in cool condition, so to keep the quality of the samples intact for the later analysis. Then now we arrived to the analysis of the blood samples. So which parameters I look inside the blood to understand the health status of the sharks? So two set of parameters. So first, physiological parameters, basic physiological parameters in the whole blood. So in the blood that was sampled straight away from the sharks without doing anything. And then basically I centrifuge, so I separated the blood. So when you separate the blood, then you have the plasma above and then the red blood cell below, the erythrocyte. So I analyzed in the erythrocyte, in the red blood cell, specific protein as indicator of stress. So just briefly explaining the physiological parameters that I analyze in the whole blood. So I analyze the glucose, as the glucose is the level of the sugar in the blood, so is the main source of energy for the organism. Then I analyze the lactate. So lactate is an indicator of the anaerobic condition of the sharks. So basically, as we are doing aerobic and anaerobic respiration, when we are doing anaerobic respiration means that we are running out of oxygen. So we need to peak to other sources of energy, and this then is going to accumulate lactate. Then how I analyze the glucose and lactate? Basically, I use the medical devices, so devices that are actually used by humans, so by diabetic people, by athletes. So it was actually an easy way to analyze this parameter. So I just put a drop of blood, of the whole blood that you see from the syringe, to the strip inside the device. Then I close the device, and just after a few seconds, the device was giving me the value, the corresponding level of lactate and glucose. Then I analyze the hemoglobin. So hemoglobin is the protein responsible for the transport of the oxygen in our blood. And I analyze the hemoglobin, again using a medical device that is actually used in hospital. So I put a drop of blood inside this microcuvette by capillary action, and then I put the microcuvette in the instrument, and again, after a few seconds, the instrument was giving me the level of the hemoglobin of the sample that I was analyzing in that moment. Then finally, as a last physiological parameter, I analyze the hematocrit. Basically, the hematocrit is the ratio of red blood cell of the erythrocyte respect to the total amount of blood. So, and this is an indicator of the oxygen capacity. So how I analyze this hematocrit, so I put basically, again, a few microliters of blood in these microcapillary tubes that by capillary action was sucking the blood. Then I close one extremity of the capillary tubes with works to have one extremity closed, and then I put these microcapillary tubes inside a specific centrifuge that is called a microcentrifuge. And then after the centrifuge, we got the separation of the different parts of the blood. And basically, with a plastic ruler, I was measuring the amount of red blood cell respect to the total amount of blood. So interesting fact, actually, at the African Penguin Sanctuary here, they are sampling the blood of the penguins exactly using these microcapillary tubes. So they're actually understanding when the penguins come to the sanctuary about the health status of the penguins, sampling the blood using the same tubes. Then what happened? So these physiological parameters were, as I said, I used the medical devices, so easy way to study this to analyze, to get the level of this physiological parameter. So something that I could do in a remote environment like French Polynesia. But then for later analysis of the protein, I need to have specific equipment, laboratory equipment. So we decided to ship the samples from French Polynesia to Italy. I don't suggest to anyone to underwent to these bureaucratic paperwork because it was really a long process, but we did it. So there I got my dry shipper. So how we did it, so we got this container that is a specific container that you can fill with liquid nitrogen. So keep the temperature inside the container even until minus 70 degrees Celsius. So in this way, we were able to store the sample inside. So keeping the temperature low for a long period of time, this is specifically designed for a long transport of samples, so to keep the samples intact and readable for further analysis. So I got my sample to Italy. Then, once in Italy, I analyzed a specific protein in the red blood cell. So, as I said before, I got the syringe with the whole blood, then I centrifuged this whole blood, then I separated the parts of the blood, and I just got the red blood cell, the erythrocyte. What are these proteins? So basically, they are proteins that are present in every organism, so even in humans, and they're proteins that they are present at a basic level in normal condition, and then they are expressed, so they are increasing concentration by the organism in a stressful condition. So to cope with the stress, so to avoid any damage at cellular level, we increase the concentration of this protein in the body. Okay, so I analyze these proteins that are called HIS-SHOT proteins. How I analyze this protein with a specific technique of molecular biology, that is the Western blotting technique. So it's a really complex procedure with a lot of steps. So I think that in this talk tonight, I don't want to undergo to all the steps of this procedure because I think it's not also super interesting. But if you're interested, of course, you can just after come to me and I will explain you all the passages of this fantastic procedure. So basically, it's just in few words, is a procedure that permits to separate all the protein present in the blood. So they are separated by molecular weight. So different proteins, they have different molecular weight. So they are separated during the run that you can see on the corner there. And then with specific antibodies, I treat this filter. So they were going to attach to the protein that I wanted to analyze. And then with a fluorescent reaction, I got the intensity of the protein, so the concentration of the protein inside the blood. So, but which are the main findings then of all the parameters that they analyzed in the blood? So, in theory, these are all the graphs that I got. Again, I will not explain tonight all the results with these graphs. I just want to give you a brief summary about the main findings, so the interesting result. So basically, we saw that from the first physiological parameter, so glucose and lactate, the sharks in both conditions, so in the cold stress and in the warm stress, they experienced a physiological stress, and in particular, they experienced a decrease of oxygen in the blood. So we saw that because we saw a strong decrease of glucose, both in the cold stress and in particular in the warm stress. And in parallel, I saw that the lactate was increasing learning a lot. So this means basically that they undergo to a reaction that is the anaerobic glycolysis. So in absence of oxygen, basically the sharks in this case, they had to take an alternative way to produce energy, because without the oxygen, they had to take something else to get the energy necessary for all the vital function. So basically they uptake glucose from the muscles and from the blood in my case to do this, this reaction, and then as a product of this reaction they got energy and they got lactate. So this is why then I saw a lot of lactate accumulated in the blood and the glucose decreasing. So they wanted to take another source of energy in absence of oxygen. So they underwent to a condition of anaerobiosis. Okay, so less oxygen available. And this was actually confirmed by the analysis of the hemoglobin and the hematocrit. So the hemoglobin decreased, again, in both conditions, so warm stress and cold stress. So this means, again, because the hemoglobin is the responsible of the transport of the oxygen in the blood, so less hemoglobin means less capacity to transport this oxygen in the blood. So again, a deficit of oxygen that they experience, and the hematocrit also decreased. So also what we suppose is that a stress related to the temperature caused a damage to the red blood cell. So the red blood cell went to into a process that is called apoptosis, that is actually the death of the cell. So less red blood cell, again, means less capacity to transport the oxygen. So they overall experience a physiological stress due to the absence of enough oxygen. And in particular, this was observed in warm conditions. So we saw that in warm conditions with higher temperature, they experience an higher physiological stress, okay? Then, so they experience actually this physiological stress, but also they could adapt. Why? Potentially thanks to other mechanisms at cellular level that they increase their kind of adaptability. So indeed what we saw, what we expected actually, was a significant increase of the issue of proteins. So proteins that, as I said before, they're proteins that are usually increasing concentration in case of stress to protect the organism. So this means that higher issue of protein expressed in the blood means higher protection level for the sharks. So they experience that again in both conditions, so cold stress and warm stress. So this means high protection at cellular level, besides the physiological stress that they experience. And this was in particular under cold condition. So this means that probably the sharks, they had to increase the amount of protein in cold condition, because maybe a cold condition for these sharks was something unusual for them, because they are tropical species, so they are adapted to warm conditions. So cold condition, they can probably cause a higher physiological stress. So what is also interesting is that higher amount of issue protein means actually a lower physiological stress. So one arrow is double arrow is actually an higher increase or an higher decrease. So higher increase of proteins means lower physiological stress because of the protection at cellular level, and lower increase of issue protein, so just one arrow, means double arrow at physiological level. So higher physiological stress because you have less amount of protein that can protect you at cellular level. Okay, so issue protein, we demonstrate that they were actually a process that the sharks used in order to cope with the physiological stress that we're experiencing due to the temperature variation. So what we conclude is actually that because both stresses, so cold stress and warm stress, they lead the sharks to experience a physiological stress, so absence of enough oxygen, as we saw from the first analysis, but the adaptation of these sharks is actually still possible thanks to some mechanism at the first line, at the base, thanks to which they can cope with the physiological stress and they can still adapt to the new condition and survive. So what we did in the laboratory, this is the graph that I showed you before about what I did in the laboratory. So I changed the temperature of 2 degrees Celsius, and as you see, is actually corresponding to the temperature variation that they're experiencing nowadays in the lagoon. So I got this graph with data regarding, because we put some temperature logger inside the lagoon, so to monitor the temperature variation of the lagoon, and we actually saw that the sharks that were daily experiencing a variation of the temperature of 2 degrees Celsius, that was the one that we replicate in the laboratory. So we can say that nowadays the newborn sharks, they are physiologically affected by the temperature variation of the lagoon. So temperature variation is having an impact of the newborn sharks, but these sharks, they're still able to adapt to this condition, probably thanks to mechanisms at cellular level, like the expression of D-shot protein that can form as a form of a protective barrier against this physiological stress. So they are fine, but in the future, because in the light of the climate change, short-term variations are expected to be more intense and more frequent for the climate change. So further research is needed to understand if this cellular mechanism, like the expression of D-shot protein, they are still enough to cope with the physiological stress related to the temperature or not. And this is quite crucial to understand, because actually research on neonatal sharks is fundamental, because on neonatal sharks, of course, depend the recruitment of all the adult population of sharks. So what next? So basically what I would like to do in my future is like to continue to make research about vulnerable species, about sharks in particular, but also communicate science, marine conservation to the people, because I think that communication is an essential part in marine conservation, because knowledge is crucial. What you know is actually, if the people know about the importance of sharks, of the marine biodiversity in the ocean, they're actually more keen, more prone to conserve what they know. So communication is something that I definitely want to keep, continue to do it, and is actually what I'm doing here. So where you can find me now, besides the bicycle where I'm driving every day. So I'm always aboard Slashfin, so guiding the shark cage diving trips. And then I also in the office, helping also Ralph with this Seven Gill project. So we are actually basically trying to create a sort of database about Seven Gill sharks, so of the bay, so to understand more about their distribution, their abundancy, because it's a species that here is actually understudied. So this is where you can find me now. And I think I said everything, so thank you very much. I hope that was not too long and not too boring. And yes, thank you. How much is it? No.
Thank you, Elena.
Thank you, too.
Okay, everybody, those who listen carefully, if you have any questions, you're welcome to ask Elena any questions. We only have this one mic tonight, so please, when you ask questions, just make sure everyone can hear. Thank you.
Oh, there is one question. Thank you, too.
I understand what you're doing, but did you actually focus on their white growth? Or that 14-day period or 15-day period that you took them out of the ocean, you took the tank and you released them again, compared to the natural growth inside the lagoon?
Yes. So you mean the short term that I look, and not in the long term? Because I look at...
You the shark in the lagoon in the natural environment will eat a certain amount of food. When you move them to your tanks, you're feeding them 5 grams per...
5% of the body weight, yes.
So that 5% should increase over the 15-day period, I would assume.
All right. No, it was always constant, the amount of food that we were giving them. Actually, it was a little bit less, the amount of food that they're actually eating on the lagoon, because was we were trying to reduce the stress as much as possible in the tanks, but they were actually eating a little bit less than what they're supposed to probably eat in the lagoon. So we were giving just 5% of the body weight of the food, but like the amount was not increasing, but even if it was increasing, they were not able actually to eat like more food that we were giving them. So it was always a little amount of food, and that we saw that was the necessary amount of food to keep them in the basic health condition in the tanks. Yeah.
Yeah, I know there's a there's an energy sacrifice in terms of producing proteins to counter physiological change at cellular level. How sustainable is the performance of that increase in protein production? Do the sharks manage to maintain it, or does it quickly taper off?
Yes, so actually is also the meaning why we wanted to keep at least like not sampling, for instance, the blood of sharks just in the field, as I show in the video, and then releasing the back the sharks in the wild, because if you pick the concentration of the protein in one just single moment, then it would not be meaningful. So these proteins are actually modulating. So they're actually changing constantly their concentration through the time. So was in, was important for us to have a period of sampling in which we were able to properly see the modulation of this protein, how they were changing through the time. So this is why we decided to do this sampling time. So once at the beginning to understand which was the starting level of the protein, so to have a sort of reference, because otherwise you don't know if the protein is considered a high level or a low level, because you don't know which is the starting point. So starting point, then the level during the stress, so to see actually if according to the starting point was actually increasing or not, and then the recovery. So we wanted to see through the time how was this modulation of the protein. So without a single sampling was not meaningful to properly have a value of the protein and to give actually a meaning to that level of the protein. So it's important with this kind of analysis to make several sampling through the times to actually see which is the modulation of this protein. Yeah.
So you began control at the beginning and at the end.
Exactly, yes. And at the end also was interesting to understand if after the stress apply, they were able to be back at the normal condition or the stress was still on the sharks. So actually, I didn't show it because it was on the graph, but the stress was still on during the recovery period. So the level of the protein was still high, but it is actually also meaningful of the fact that they were still able to cope with the stress with an high level of proteins, because also during the recovery period, if the level of protein is too low, maybe it's something, it's also because the shark is experiencing too much stress, so even the cellular mechanism, it's not useful anymore to cope with the stress. So means that they keep this stress at high this protection mechanism at high level through all the time until we release them back the sharks. Yeah. I hope that I answered. Yes. Yes.
Anyone else? Okay, guys, I need to admit that I did not say welcome to everyone that joined us online. We were also streaming on YouTube tonight. So for those listening online, thank you so much. We appreciate the support.
Hello.
If there's any questions, I know that the timing is a bit behind, but if you have questions, just type it up. If we don't answer them here, we can answer them in the comments afterwards. Okay, guys, so if there's no further questions, thank you so much again for making the effort coming through tonight with the weather we're having. I want to thank you, the Great White House, for preparing the soup and bread we're going to enjoy afterwards while you guys mingle and get to know each other. And once again, thank you for coming. We're working on our next marine evening, which might be 2 weeks from now. Just keep that date in mind. We will confirm closer to date. So that's it from us, and hope you have a wonderful evening. Thanks again.
Thank you.